six talks on the Compass of Zen by our founding teacher, Zen Master Seung Sahn. We're extremely happy to that he's consented to do this. Consented is actually the wrong word. It was his idea. He said, something do it necessary. So in this world being in the shape it's in, something do it is necessary. So we're doing it. So the format of these talks is that each night a different student will give talk on part of the Compass of Zen, and the Master Seung Sahn will answer questions. I think we need to keep that closed because it's just too noisy. Zen Master Seung Sahn is the 78th patriarch in the line going back to the Buddha, was born in Korea, achieved enlightenment at the age of 22, and has been teaching in the West since 1972, and now has Zen centers all over the world. Next to him is Mu Ryang Sunim, who has been a monk in our school for over 10 years, graduated from Yale, was recently avid here, but now has gone on to greener pastures, and he'll be giving the introductory talk. So, thank you all very much for coming.
Well, thank you, Mukang Kim, for that introduction. I have the enviable task of giving the introductory talk on the Compass of Zen teaching, which is actually the easiest. It's only one or two pages long, but I thought I would start off by saying that in Oriental medicine, an oft-quoted phrase is that you cure a hot sickness with a hot medicine and a cold sickness with a cold medicine. So Sun Sunim has often said that for word and speech medicine, which all human beings seem to have, you will cure that with words and speech. Word and speech sickness you cure with words and speech medicine. So many, many teachings have appeared. As Mukanshin said, I went to Yale University and I used to work in the Beinecke Rare Book Library, which was this cube of a building with no windows and it's just marble sides and very dark inside, kind of very mystical. And on the second floor, in a very, very prominent place, they had this lighted cabinet in the midst of this eerily dark room, huge hall, with the Gutenberg Bible in it. And for those of you who don't know, the Gutenberg Bible is the example of the, it's the first example of something printed with movable type in the West. And they make a big deal out of it, owning that copy. And it's a very beautiful book, actually. Very colorful and everything. But it's one book. And probably many of you have read the Bible. I know I have. You can basically sit down and read it in, read the New Testament in one afternoon or so, and read the whole thing in a couple days. It's not a very imposing book. But if you went two floors down in the same Beinecke Rare Book Library, there was a whole collection of Tibetan Buddhist sutras. And those are sutras in Tibet. What they do, instead of making a book with bindings, they stack all these leaves of paper that have been printed with something, woodblock or something, on top of each other and kind of sandwich it with two boards, something like that, and then they tie them together. But the whole floor was covered with these things. I mean, it was a whole floor devoted to Tibetan Buddhist sutras. So you have one book of the Bible, but this huge expanse of Tibetan Buddhist sutras, because Tibetan sutras are the example of the, like the best example of all the Sanskrit sutras in Buddhism, best preserved. And they were all freeze-dried and everything to prevent insects from getting in them. Well, years after that, I was lucky enough to live in Korea for a while and made many pilgrimages to a certain temple in Korea which is called Haeinsa. It's the Dharma Treasure Temple in Korea, and they have two huge buildings, not just floors, but buildings, probably almost as long as one city block each, filled with sutras. And the Korean version of the sutras are the best preserved collection of the whole Chinese Buddhist sutras. So this was two whole buildings full of sutras printed on wood or carved on wood blocks. So if we're going to cure our word and speech sickness with word and speech medicine, we've got a lot of reading to do. Whether we choose the Tibetan sutras or the Korean sutras, it's a lot of reading. And you just go downstairs and look in our library, any one book is a huge, like the Threefold Lotus Sutra or whatever, it's a huge amount of reading. And then try to read it. It's dense, to say the least. But we were very lucky because we have a quick cure for our sickness. One small little pill which we can take, and it's in the form of the Compass of Zen teaching. So that's what we're going to be discussing and asking questions about in the next week. And we're really lucky. Sun Sunim actually has distilled this whole collection of Buddhist sutras down to one small little book, which is very easy to handle. It's so easy that many of us who have done this particular series of lectures year after year, especially in the early years, thought, oh, bah, boo, this is boring, especially when somebody like me was giving the introductory talk. It was very tedious in the middle of the summer. But I was lucky enough to sit through about a dozen or so lectures that Sun Sunim gave himself without an introductory talk, and he's in Korean, and he's incredibly eloquent, and it made me appreciate this particular teaching much more. So I hope that we can all get a real lot out of this whole experience, and I want to thank you all for coming very much, and I want to thank Sun Sunim very much for not only making this book, but again and again and again giving us the opportunity and being there for us to go over this material. So probably no one in this room, certainly not myself, would disagree that life somehow is sometimes less than satisfying, or as it's translated in Buddhism, life is suffering. I was just talking with Nisangsin tonight, surprised for some reason that I'm often not completely satisfied. And that's our life. We don't get what we want. So often this world is called a suffering ocean in Buddhism. Gohei in Korean, suffering ocean. And how do we get across the suffering ocean? Because no one wants to suffer. Well, we take a ship. And in Buddhism, they say you take a ship of wisdom, the banya boat, the wisdom boat. Well, we can either take, we can get on this boat, but if we don't know where we're going, we're just like a piece of driftwood. And we could end up anywhere, maybe on an iceberg somewhere in the North Atlantic. So we need a compass. We need some kind of navigation. And that's what Sun Sunim has come up with, the Compass of Zen teaching. This is a compass or a navigation device to help us find our direction in crossing this ocean of suffering. So if I think everybody probably has a copy. We'll start in. And the purpose of Buddhism. Now this, if you don't get anything else out of this whole lecture, this is like the kernel or the seed of all Buddhist teaching. Everything in Buddhism boils down to this one thing, two things actually. First, attain enlightenment, then instruct all creatures. So any kind of Buddhism, and Buddhism is an incredibly wide religion or philosophy or what have you, practice. There's many, many different things. Everything boils down to this. Attain enlightenment and instruct all creatures. Well, Buddha, as we all know, was searching for a long time and ended up eventually, after 6 years of austerities and hard practice, sitting under the Bodhi tree and keeping this question, this don't know mind, what am I, or what is life, or what is death, and one day saw a star in the sky and got enlightenment. Well, after that, he thought, no one, this is too subtle, this is too difficult. No one's going to believe me if I told them about this. So he just ended up sitting under the Bodhi tree for several weeks, actually. This is kind of a lesser known part of the history. He just kind of camped out in the Bodhi tree, enjoying himself, perhaps, thinking it was useless to try to tell this to anybody, because how could this be expressed in words and speech? Well, finally, one of the gods of the heaven, named Brahma, in the Indian pantheon, came down to him and bowed to him and said, please, there are actually people in this world who have just a little dust in front of their eyes, not too much dust, and if you tried to teach them, maybe you could take away this dust and they could wake up and attain enlightenment too. So Buddha said, okay, I will do that, and he thought about it. The two teachers that he had in his spiritual quest were both dead by that time, so he said he couldn't teach them, but there were these five Dharma friends that he had during his hard practice, and he thought, okay, I'll see if they are interested. So he went to where he knew that they were and started teaching, and they listened to him and became his first disciples. His first monk disciples, actually. According to the story, he met some lay people on the road who saw that he was glowing and obviously had attained something and bowed to him and became his disciples also. So anyways, Buddha attained enlightenment and then began teaching. My own experience is that it's not so cut and dry. And I know a lot of us have often thought, how can I start teaching if I haven't gotten it myself, if I haven't attained enlightenment yet? People say, well, I'll attain enlightenment first and then I'll start teaching. And actually, in some traditions, like Japan, to name one, the students are not allowed to even open their mouth and speak until 20 years have passed, until they have supposedly got something. But I think it was Wan Hyo, a famous Korean Zen monk, who said, or a famous Korean monk, about 1,000 years ago, who said, wisdom and practice are like two wings of a bird. So you can't have correct practice without some wisdom. You can't have correct wisdom without practice. So they go together. Attaining enlightenment and instructing other people cannot really be separated. They're kind of two wings of a bird or two wheels of a cart. Wan Hyo also says that helping oneself and helping other people are like two wheels of a cart. A cart won't go without both wheels. So even in this book, it says, instead of it doesn't say first attain enlightenment in the Chinese, it says Sang de Bodhi, which is above, attain Bodhi or enlightenment, and then below, Ha Wa Jung Sang, is below, save all beings or teach all beings. So above and below, you cannot really be separated. You can't have below without above. You can't have above without below. So we can't have practice in our own enlightenment without teaching. We can't have teaching without enlightenment. So that's what we're doing here tonight. And we'll be doing this for the next week and probably many, many years to come. Anyways, Buddhism is divided up into three parts, as we all know. What we call Hinayana Buddhism, Mahayana Buddhism, and Zen Buddhism. And depending on the tradition that you're studying, they'll divide this up differently. Like the Tibetans divided up Hinayana, Mahayana, and Vajrayana, and throw Zen in with the Mahayana. So, and the Hinayana, they won't even say that. Say Theravadan, that's the only Buddhism, and then Mahayana or Zen is an aberrant form. So it really depends on who you're talking, who you're listening to, you're listening to me tonight, and hopefully they come to me soon. So we're going to say Hinayana, Mahayana, Zen. And this is really an interesting breakdown. Hinayana means small vehicle, little vehicle. Mahayana means great vehicle. So Sun Sunim often uses the analogy of Hinayana Buddhism is like you want to go from Los Angeles to New York. So you get on your bicycle or your scooter or maybe your motorcycle and you go out 10 and then you just get on 40 and keep going across the country. You can stay on 40 all the way through the Texas desert and all the way on. And eventually you'll get to the East Coast and you can go up to New York. But the road is very clear. First you go here, then you go there, then you go there. And you're going alone on your bicycle or motorcycle. But Mahayana Buddhism is like taking a bus or a train. Many, many people get on the same vehicle with you, and you're all going together from LA to New York. But you go by the same road. First you go out 10 and then get on 40, or maybe you're going to go up to San Francisco and go out 80 or something. But you take a definite road, there's signs along the way, and you go step by step, and eventually you arrive in New York. But Zen is not like that. As Sun Sunim is fond of saying, Zen is like you go to the airport, you get in the airplane, boom, the airplane's in the sky, there's no road, and then 5 hours later you land in New York. Very quick, and there's no map that you can, there's no road, there's no road signs or anything like that. So that's why Zen is not a very popular practice, because there's not a lot of road signs along the way. This happens to be one road sign that we're using tonight. Although, if you practice Zen, you'll find that everything is pulled away from you if you're depending on it. So, I have my little crib sheet here, and hopefully you won't pull it away. So, another way to look at it is Hinayana Buddhism is going, we live in a world of form, and Hinayana Buddhism goes from form to emptiness. There's, you know, the famous Buddhist teaching of life is suffering, and that's really because this world is impermanent. Everything is changing, 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 but that's form. Form is always changing, so if we attach to form, then we have suffering. So that's Buddha's original teaching. So Hinayana Buddhism goes from form to emptiness. Emptiness being in Hinayana, nirvana, attained nirvana. Mahayana goes from emptiness to form. So starting from the point of no I, they don't talk about impermanence or suffering or all of the standard Buddhist teachings. You'll remember from what we just chanted tonight, the Heart Sutra. No form, no feeling, no perceptions, no impulses, no consciousness, no suffering, no origination, no stopping, and no path. It's completely refuting all of the codified early Buddhist teachings, saying no, 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 no. So that's starting from emptiness, nothing. And then going to form. Form meaning truth. As Sun Sunim always says, the wall is brown, the floor is brown. We just painted the room. But the wall is actually clay bisque. And the trim is pearl something. But anyway, form being truth. So we call that Anuttara Samya Sambodhi. That's truth or complete world. So Hinayana Buddhism goes to nirvana or the absolute, not moving, not moving world. Mahayana goes from the absolute or from nirvana or from emptiness to truth, to complete world, to Anuttara Samya Sambodhi. But Zen doesn't talk about form or opposite world, doesn't talk about absolute world, doesn't talk about truth world. Zen points directly to just now, moment world. So somebody asked, I think it was Unmun Zen Master, what is Buddha? He said, dry shit on a stick. Somebody asked, Dongtan Zen master, what is Buddha? He said, 3 pounds of flax. Just now, just what am I doing now? Moment, world. So that's actually from truth to function, correct function. So that's really what Sun Tzu-min has been teaching us all these years. Another way that I've heard him talk about it, which is really interesting, is imagine a watermelon. And if you ask about a watermelon in Hinayana Buddhism, you would be told that a watermelon starts from this seed, little black seed, that somebody plants in the ground, or maybe it falls in the ground, and then it sprouts, and then a vine appears, and this vine grows, and then some little flowers appear on the vine, and then from the flowers, a fruit starts to grow, and it gets bigger and bigger and bigger, and then it turns into this big fruit, and then maybe somebody eats it, or it rots, and the seeds go back into the ground, and the whole thing starts over again. So it's around and around and around. And tomorrow we'll talk about Hinayana Buddhism, and Bridget, who will be giving the talk, will go into this thing that they call the 12 links of dependent origination. But this is like a watermelon. Seed, and then the fruit, and then the seed and fruit, around and around. So it's really talking about time, or something changing over time. Mahayana Buddhism, though, is not about time, it's about space, or I said before, form, going to form. So if you're talking about a watermelon, then you say, well, this watermelon has this green skin with kind of bands of dark and light green color around it, and it's either, if you're in the West, it's either this, it looks like this long, stretched out big football, and if you're in Korea, it looks more like a tetherball or a soccer ball. and then inside it has this red color if it's ripe, and also these little black seeds, and the watermelon is sweet, and all this explanation about what the form is, what the truth is. But Zen is not like that, and I've always loved to hear Sun Tzu-min say this. He says, Zen means you take your knife, boom, cut into your mouth. Your experience. What is a watermelon? Boom. Mmm. So, that's really wonderful. We also talk sometimes about, in terms of precepts, Hinayana Buddhism, if you're thinking in terms of precepts, which are the rules of conduct in Buddhism, Hinayana Buddhism is concerned about the form of the precepts. So, do this, don't do that, keep your body this way, and you have to kind of observe things by the letter, the rule. Mahayana precepts are mind precepts, which means your action is not so important. It's your thinking or your mind, which is very important. So even in Christianity, Jesus talks about this when he says, even if you have one lustful thought, you've already committed adultery. So that's pretty rarefied, high-class, difficult teaching. And that's more Mahayana style. Action's not so important as thinking. But Zen means, Zen precepts are, why do something? Action's not important, thinking's not important. Why? Your intention is very important. So why do something? So that's another way of, there's a story about that, and that's probably one that most people have heard. 2 monks were out walking from one temple to another. It may have been a long time ago in China. They came to a river, and the flood had swollen the river so that it had overflowed its ford, and the ferry couldn't go back and forth. And there was a beautiful woman standing on this side of the river, and she had all these fine silk clothes on, and she was standing there because she couldn't cross this river without getting completely wet or taking her clothes off or something. So she was just standing there, and without thinking, one of the monks realized her situation and just probably excused himself. I'm sure he didn't just pick her up. But anyway, he carried her across the river and set her down on the other side, and they continued walking. Well, the younger monk who had watched this finally, after a couple hours, couldn't contain himself anymore and blurted out, We're monks. We're not supposed to touch women. How could you pick up this? How could you hold this woman? And the older monk said, I put the woman down on the other side of the stream. Why are you still carrying her around? So that's a really good example of Hinayana, this younger monk who asked the question, and Mahayana, this older monk. He had completely taken this out of his, off his mind, so he wasn't holding it anymore. But I remember once Sun Sunim told the story and said, both are not correct. If he was this older monk, he would have said, is that good or bad? And hit this younger monk even stronger. So that Zen style is almost giving mind acupuncture to people to take away their attachments or our attachments. And it's never the same. It's not something you can write down. You won't find it in here, although the words are in here. It's really necessary if you need mind acupuncture to find a good mind acupuncturist. And we have one sitting right next to us, fortunately. So that's the divisions of Buddhism. And finally, we come to the structure of Buddhism, which there's a beautiful little chart here if you have a book on page 2. This is really can be very deep and involved and long-winded philosophy, philosophical explanation, and I'll try to go over it briefly. In Buddhism, we have three treasures, three jewels, three precious ones, the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha. In the first chant that we did tonight, we paid homage to the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha. So what are these? Well, there are different kinds of three treasures, and the original or historical three treasures are the Buddha, the historical Buddha Shakyamuni, who, as I talked about before, got enlightenment under the Bodhi tree and began teaching. This was about 2,500 years ago. And the Dharma was the words that he spoke, and the Sangha were the community of people who listened to his teaching and then practiced it. So that's the original Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. Well, there's also an existent Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. On our altar here we have the Buddha, and in any temple or in most Zen centers or Buddhist centers all over the world, you'll find a Buddha on the altar or something similar or representing the Buddha. So that's the existent Buddha. And then the existent Dharma are these sutras, which I talked about. A copy of the Tibetan sutras are in the Beinecke Rare Book Library, and the Korean sutras are all printed on wood blocks in Heian-sa Temple. You can also go to any bookstore or library and buy sutras. Those are the existent sutras. And then the existent Sangha is none other than, here we are, the Sangha, and anybody tonight in other Buddhist centers all across Los Angeles or Southern California or all over the country or all over the world or who knows, all over the universe, who are somehow trying to understand what's going on, have some question. You can expand this notion of Sangha to include everything. Kwan Roshi is very fond of talking about the Maha Sangha, so I'll just bring that up and let it be at this point. But there is another kind of Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, and that is the transcendental Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, the transcendental three treasures. And that's actually written on a calligraphy that used to be right behind in the back of our Dharma room, but now it's down in this hall here. And it basically says, Buddha is clear and pure mind. Dharma is bright, light mind. And Sangha is no hindrance mind. So that is the transcendental Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. It's not some tangible thing like the historical Buddha or the Buddha on the altar. It's something that we have to attain and experience inside ourselves. Clear and pure. Bright and light. Or also no hindrance. So Sun Sunima always, when he talks about this, finishes it with saying that there's one more three treasure, and that is when somebody asks Joju Zen Master any kind of question, he would always say, "Go drink tea." So that's the triple jewel of Zen. Cut off any kind of thinking, any kind of idea. Drink tea, then your experience. Okay, almost there. So, I don't know if any of you have practiced yoga, but I used to, before I became a Zen student, I was a yoga student, and we had three divisions in yoga practice too. One was devotional, and then we had intellectual, and then there was karma yoga. But it roughly corresponds to this. In Buddhism, the Buddha treasure is the object of faith, the object that we can believe in or devote to. And it corresponds to this inside structure in the human consciousness, which is intellect, emotion, and will. Human beings have this inside structure too. And the Buddha treasure is the emotional side of our consciousness. So if we cut off our thinking, then we can attain this mind where everything is beautiful, because beauty comes from our emotional consciousness. And if we're thinking, then we can't perceive true beauty. But if we cut off thinking, which means samadhi, keeping a not moving mind, then we attain beauty. The Dharma is the intellectual side, or philosophical side. And that means attaining wisdom, or truth. Sunim says, wrote here, going from ignorance to enlightenment. So, our intellect is very, very important when we're practicing. We have to really use our thinking and understand this world. Everybody has some lingering attachment, something they want. We all have it. I want this or I want that, and it often does not appear for a long time. And if we're practicing and then suddenly this lingering attachment appears, if our intellect is not functioning correctly, we can just follow this desire mind or some kind of feeling. But if our intellect is working correctly, then that's just my feeling. This world, we can really still perceive what this world is in truth, even though we have some desire or some feeling. So this intellect, correct view, as some people call it, is very important. Then the third part, the Sangha, corresponds to the will, our will in our consciousness. And so we talk about precepts. It's the ethical side of our nature. And these three things, our intellect, our emotions, and our will, have to be in balance. And practicing, I think we've all found, anybody who's done practicing has found that practicing really brings these three things into balance. We have chanting. Every morning and every evening we do this chanting, which really helps our emotional consciousness. People get a very good feeling after chanting. We have Kongan practice, which is food for our intellect, and then cutting that off. And we have sitting, which really is will, and bowing. So our practice is really well designed for the different aspects of our consciousness. Anyways, when these things come together, our intellect, emotions, and will, then it means that our faith, our understanding or wisdom, and our practice come together. And if those three things come together, then that's called moksha, or moksha is the Sanskrit word for liberation, or holiness, it says here. So that is the structure of Buddhism. And I thank you all very much for bearing with me tonight. And now I would like to turn Sun Sunim loose on you all. I mean, turn it over to Sun Sunim. And if you have any questions about anything that I've talked about tonight or anything at all, actually, I hope that you'll ask him. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, in Mu Ryang Sunim. Very good Dharma speech. Also very good talk. So also thank you very much everybody coming here, listen to the Compass of Zen teaching. That is a very important book. First I came and I stayed many kind of Buddhism. Tibetan Buddhism and Hinayana Buddhism, Mahayana Buddhism, Japanese Buddhism, Korean Buddhism, many kinds of Buddhism. So they said, my Buddhism is correct. Also, the Japanese Buddhism, many separate, you know. They had Genting Buddhism, Sutra Buddhism, also Namho Rengekyo Buddhism. Namho Rengekyo Buddhism is very strong, only Namho Rengekyo. Other kinds of Buddhism, not so good, this type, talking. So, how is that this, you know, many on Apache Day Buddhism? How does it make clear, you know? So, make this book. So, this book is Nana Buddhism, Mahayana Buddhism, Zen Buddhism, all set. Then, if you understand Komatsu, this book, then understand, my Buddhism is this part, my Buddhism is that part, that. Whole understand what kind of Buddhism. So we make this. So today we begin teaching, Compass of teaching. First is Mu Ryang Sunim, very good Dharma teach. So everybody has a question. Three times today. Today we are three kinds of listening. That's what is three kinds.
Yeah.
So any kind of question, not only this book, not only okay.
Thank you very much for your talk. It was very nice. Thank you. This people look at this and they want to say, yes, I would like to get rid of my suffering, but I enjoy my children. I enjoy my family. I enjoy some things, but I don't enjoy this. I don't enjoy that. I don't enjoy this. In this Zen, as you talk about it here, how is correct practice will keep a person from, you understand?
Yeah. How helpful those people?
Yes.
Together action. Together action very important. Somebody don't like, I don't like this, I don't like this, I don't like this. Then you say to him, I also don't like this, don't like this, don't like this. Oh, you're my friend. Who's to make a friend necessary? Okay. One of my students, he before many years, he said, yeah, so New Haven student. He before many hippie action, you know, 6 years on hippie style. Same as you, okay, long hair, rocking clothes. So 7 years is coming, going here, sometimes stay home, sometimes go, yeah, many, you know, this, 1970, 1965, that time, many hippies in the United States. So, only hippie action. So, this parent, anytime she coming back, man, 1 week, not the body, not washing clothes, that's mad. But she don't like, his parents don't like him, so that, she like that. Then after he practiced, he understand, he be only not correct. Then strong practice. You get understand, that's the correct way. So, no more hippie action. No more. Every day practice. Then he attained something. Buddhism, practice, then return to home. Correct, return to home. You know, help this father, help mother. Then, my son a little better nowadays. She got Buddhism at the Zen Center, then I practice a little better. Then, strong idea appeared. That idea means Buddhism is correct. Then, anytime his father may attach the money, attach the thing, attach the talking to you. Then the song of that. Father, you no good. You too much. No good, no good. Then father said, why? What is no good? I am already almost 50 years old. No. I understand everything. What is no good? Always fighting. Then one day, a student come in my place. I go to that at that time. She said, sometimes I have problem. What kind of problem? My father, wrong my life. I am better than, United States President. I am better than Abraham Lincoln. So my idea, number one good idea. Also, very attached money, attached thing. So how I cannot teach my father? How I can teach father? So I said, you know good. Your father better than you. Then they're angry. Well, my father done, not practicing. I did very attached. What is better than me? So you don't understand Buddhism. You don't understand Zen. Okay. That's you think about Zen Buddhism number one, this time I inside your head. I want to teach my father that mind. That mind number one, bad mind. You must keep this mind. Listen to me. Put it down. Any mind, any idea, any Buddhism also completely done. And you must understand what is your father. Your father attached money, attached wine, attached fame, many kinds of things attached. Then every week, Sunday or holiday, you could wine, okay, or high kind of cognac. Then take home, give to your father. And your father talk about, now American president is no good, this is no good, then, wonderful, that's correct. You are better than legal, better than somebody, Only up, you're number one. My father number one this type speech, never bad speech. And the half of you get some money, then give some money. Please, this is my working, this half money, I give it to you. Then your father, very happy, my son's wonderful. So he tried that, Complete. Take away all my money. Go home. Cleaning house, clean half mother, then with the father time, I buy some good, this cognac, please take this cognac. Then father, you're crazy? Why bring a cognac? No, I'm not crazy. People are crazy, not crazy. You like to say, you know, cognac, but I buy cognac for you. Then, oh, wonderful. You are my son, wonderful son. This time I love you. Then, any kind, you are better than Deagle, better than somebody, better than this, this, that. Only you are wonderful, wonderful. Then, oh, my son, now he's a very good, my son, you know, very happy. Then, any time, correct action from the him. Never talk Buddhism, never talk about that meditation, only happiness and happiness. So mother very happy, father also very happy. Then so, my son very changing his life, very good action. Then he, Zen Buddhism, maybe meditation that changing mind. Then one day, his father asked him, oh, what is meditation? Oh, no, I'm not talking about meditation in front of you. You talk meditation, maybe you are getting angry to me. No, no, I'm not angry to you. What is meditation? Then slow, teaching him. Oh, that's not bad. Then together 10 minutes, practicing. But then slow up, then finally, his father, Kamijendra. Now they very good Zen student. The father also very good Zen student. That's very important. First, to get the action. Very important, to get the action. Okay? To get the action, to get the action, to get the action. Then listen to you. Good, bad, but don't check. Good and bad. Okay? Good. Try that. So, more questions? Any kind of questions? Let me bring your question. Okay.
So,
what? Uh-huh.
What is the difference between soul and Buddha nature?
Huh? What is the difference between soul and Buddha nature?
Or Buddha mind, or?
Maybe, Bread. Here, bread. It's a food, yeah? Food is bread, bread is food. The food is very wide. Okay? Buddha is very wide. But bread is a food, kind of food. Kind of food. Okay? Same as the kind of food. So, you ask Buddha nature and what?
Soul.
Soul. So that's Buddha nature very wide. Soul means human or some dog or cat as a soul. Okay, soul. But tree, rocks, or sky, have no consciousness, but have Buddha nature. Okay? Understand? But you don't understand Buddha nature, don't understand soul. Only understanding, only name. I ask you, what is Buddha nature?
Don't know.
Okay. What is the soul?
Don't
know. Correct. That's correct. Attain, don't know, then attain your soul, attain Buddha nature, okay? That is very important. That's the only name. Name. So, this name and form. Name and form comes from where? Our thinking. If you cut our thinking, then soul and Buddha nature become one. Then attain Buddha nature, attain your soul. That's the point. Okay? So more questions? Okay.
Would you please explain it in more detail what anatta is?
Hmm? What is this anatta? No self?
Yes.
What is no self?
Hmm. But my understanding is that that was one of Buddha's teachings that was quite different from teaching that existed before his enlightenment. And I would like you to maybe go in more detail about it.
She said, what is no self? Can you explain Buddhism teaching?
Buddhism teaching means we talk about that attain our true self. Then wisdom appear. Okay. Humanity too much understanding, many understanding. Understanding means somebody's idea, not your idea. So you must digest the understanding necessary. So understanding, yeah, sky blue, trees green, dog barking, sugar is sweet, everything, they are all understanding. But the sky never say I am blue. Tree never say I am green. When a human being says sky blue, trees green, dog barking, woof woof, okay? Yeah? But the American people say dog barking, woof woof. Korean people say never talk about him, walk forward, dog barking is a mong mong. Okay? Go to Poland, then dog barking, how. The how, walk, mong mong, which is the correct dog barking? Which one? Then human beings barking, okay? Korean people barking, American people barking, Poland people barking, not dog barking. So, same. Humans make something, name and the form. This is a guy, this is a tree, this is a human being, that is that. Many, name and the form made by thinking. So, American people said American idea, any country, they have idea. So this idea means from thinking. So thinking means always changing. Not stay one way, okay? Not stay. Only changing. So changing means not truth. Not changing. Everything changing. What is not changing? Everything changing. Okay. So everything has name and form. So name and form the changing. Return to emptiness. Name is form from emptiness. So heart structure, the form is emptiness. Emptiness is the form. That's also thinking. The practicing, name and the beyond name and the form. That we say nirvana. It's attain nirvana, that no attainment is nothing to attain. Then get nirvana. But the heart said, Anuktara Sannyasa, before no attainment. Then attain Anuktara Sannyasambodhi. Then what is Anuktara Sannyasambodhi? What is Nirvana? Two. Nirvana here, Anuktara Sannyasambodhi here. Two. What is Nirvana? Nirvana is a complete nothing. Anuktara Sannyasambodhi is the truth. So only nirvana, only state nirvana, yeah, everything is no problem. No life, no death, no coming, no going, no heart, no law. Very pure. And pure, and you get this, you know, no suffering over there. But there, attack nirvana, then into this enter them. So, get up nirvana, get up nirvana, then attain anuttara sannyasa somebody. That means truth. When you see, when you hear, when you smell, when you touch, everything truth. Sky is blue, tree is green, dog barking off, sugar is sweet. And every, what is that truth? There's no subject, no object. Sky and you become one. Tree and you become one. Dog and you become one. Everything become one. That time, that is the truth. Sky is blue, tree is green, dog barking off, sugar is sweet. Everything become one. So you are truth. That name is Anuttara Sannyasa Sambodhi. Okay? But only Anuttara Sannyasa Sambodhi not enough. One more step. How correct function truth make your correct life? That we say, Hattusa said that Gate Gate Para Gate Parasangate Bodhisattva, that means only do it. Only do it, mind. The only do it means we say Bodhisattva action. More wide means that the great love, great compassion, great Bodhisattva way. That name is Anuttara Sannyasa Sambodhi. Not Anuttara. Gate Gate Para Gate Parasangate Bodhisattva. Correct function. How attain? Use, attain, function, attain, make correct life. So in the Bible says, I am the way and the truth and life. See, I am the way is, we say, correct way. Put it down, you and everything become one. That time, attain way. Then when you see, when you hear, when you smell, everything is a truth. Then how correct function through help of the people, that's correct life. So, I am the way and the truth and the life. In Buddhism, attain universal substance, attain Dharma, okay, attain Dharma. Then, attain truth. Truth means when you see, when you hear, everything is truth. Then attain truth, then correct the function truth on the help of the people. That's correct life. That name is the Bodhisattva way. Okay? That three kinds. Okay, more question? No? Everybody attain. Wonderful. So Buddhism means huh? Question?
Yeah.
No? Buddha, he had, before went to the mountain, he had prince. So, any kind of possible, he had the power, had good situation, good family, high job, everything possible. But don't understand himself. Also, that time, many kinds of religion were there, India, Brahmin religion, okay. But that cannot help him. So he went to the mountain on the seat under the Bodhi tree. Only 6 years sitting under the Bodhi tree, 6 years, only go straight, don't know. What am I? Don't know. Huh? That one morning, so start. Boom, got enlightenment. Huh? That's the reason. Got enlightenment. Attain my true self. Attain my true self. What am I? If I don't understand, what am I? Don't know. So, attain my true self. That's very important. In sutra, many sutra appear. All sutra talk about I. What am I? what is true way? What is correct direction? Talk about that. But if you don't understand your true self, also, if you little bit understand my true self, but not believe yourself, not believe you 100%, okay? Yeah, sometimes believe, sometimes not. 100% believe you. Maybe somebody said 30%, not bad, okay? Maybe 50%, not bad. Maybe somebody said, how many percent believe yourself? 70%, not bad. Somebody said, I believe myself 99%. Very good, but very dangerous. 99% believe yourself, very dangerous. That's 1%. Sometimes this 1% all came to 99%. That's very important. So 100% believe yourself, that's very important. So here's something here, something big rocks, make road. So, but the rocks is hindrance, so make hole, it's dynamite, okay, it's dynamite. Then all rhyme is, you know, fire line. It's a fire. Burning. 99% go over there. Stop. That is the truth. 99%. 99%. Yeah, go over there. Stop. Not explode. 100% then explode, make road is possible. So 99%, 1% is the same. But 99% much dangerous. I almost Buddha, almost Buddha. I almost got the enlightenment. That's it. 1% not so much I mean, but 99% strong I mind. I already all understand, everything understand. Only 1% don't understand. Number one dangerous, that's it. So our practice, strong practicing is that. Then mind open. I am not the sky blue, trees green, dog bug. I am the truth. You understand? Do you believe your truth? Of course. How many percent? 99%. Then no problem. Okay, no problem. But 1% killed all 99% sometime. It's very dangerous. So complete 100% attain your truth. Very important. That's the correct practice. Okay. So more questions? No? Okay.
This is almost the same question she asked. One of Buddha's basic teachings is no self or no soul. I think the same meaning, no self, no soul. So the question is, what is soul?
I ask you. Who is talking to me? Who is talking to me? Who? I have sticks. Not answer, I answer to you. Okay. Who are you?
Sitting in front of you.
Huh?
Sitting in front of you.
Same as you? What is the same? Nothing. You have hair, I have no hair. What's the thing? That's a big mistake. So I hate you 30 times, okay?
Sitting at a table, saying we're different.
I hate you 30 times, okay?
And that's the bone.
The monkey.
So what is soul?
I hate you. More question?
That's Buddha's answer, but that doesn't help these people. What is soul?
What is soul?
Yeah.
You talk to me. What is soul? It's a dead soul. You have no soul, you not talk to me.
So your teaching and Buddha's teaching is different.
Huh?
Buddha said there is no soul, but you say the soul is talking to you.
What is the difference? No too much understand, you have problem. Okay? Put it all down. Understanding cannot help you. Okay? So more question? Eric, okay.
Did you say enlightenment, attaining enlightenment is like a natural process, some kind of evolution of the soul, and that
to
get enlightenment is a natural process?
There's two parts of the question.
No, one by one, okay.
First part.
First question.
Enlightenment is like a natural kind of evolution, maybe another level. It's a natural process.
You make me very complicated. What is the enlightenment? Your first question, what is enlightenment?
No, is enlightenment like?
Enlightenment like?
Is enlightenment like a natural process or by itself happening, this style?
You too much understand. You asking what is enlightenment?
No.
One by one, okay?
No, it's like,
you ask
him. He said, ask him, what is enlightenment?
Oh, what is. I can't ask you.
What color is
it?
Can I ask me? That's okay, no problem. Chameleon processing. Then you, chameleon process, yes, Zen Center, okay? Then attain your true self. Attain your true self, that's enlightenment. Okay?
And second question is,
okay.
Is a soul on enlightenment something so.
Soul?
Soul enlightenment or realization? Is it something so vast that one can never get out of it to make it an object, so it can't ever be perceived?
I don't know how to.
Okay, in other words, if it's the source of this, all of this, then it's what I would call in Christian or Hindu terms, the supreme source of subject. So therefore, it can't be an object, or else it wouldn't be what it is.
Who made the subject object? Who made subject object?
Us.
Huh? Mind? Opposite mind? What kind of opposite mind? What is absolute mind? Too much understanding has problem. Too much read book, so has problem. Completely put it down. That's all somebody's idea, not your idea. Yeah? Okay? What is your idea? What is your idea? You have your idea, have no idea?
I have
an idea. Have idea. What kind of idea have?
They go from moment to moment and they change.
What does it mean moment to moment?
Just where my attention focuses on from second to second.
Second to second? What is the second to second? Just now.
Oh, that's an idea too.
Huh?
But now I'm aware that I'm talking.
That's your thinking.
Yeah.
Your thinking not correct idea. Okay. So you told me what is the correct idea? You ask me. You say moment to moment the correct idea, you know. You say that moment to moment the correct idea.
Did I say correct?
So moment to moment, what you say?
Does his idea changing moment to moment different around and around?
You asked me for an idea. You explained. My understanding was that you asked me what ideas are.
So that's your always changing idea means not correct idea. Not changing idea is the correct idea. Not changing idea is the truth.
Not changing idea is
the truth. So you must attain not changing idea. If you have past, present, future, you have past, present, future. You have? Do you have?
Well, I see that against something. I realize against all the past, present, and future, against, that.
What is
I see that against something that I was taught, I see that against something that doesn't change.
I ask you, what is the present? What is the present?
Here, there. Present is an idea,
too. That's your idea, okay? Your idea is not correct. Present not exist. You say present or the passing. Because time is non-stop. Time is always growing, okay? Moving. So you say present or the passing?
Past and future change. The present is...
What is future?
My mind thinking about
around. Okay. This sound comes from where? This sound comes from where? Your ear? This table? This stick? This sound. From table, or stick, or air, you ear, where it comes from?
The idea is it comes from a limitless potential.
Complicated to me. Somebody said this sound comes from table, but the table have no sound.
Well,
maybe this stick makes sound, yeah? This stick makes sound. But if your stick makes sound, but have no air, then cannot make a sound. So maybe this air makes sound, okay? Listen, okay? Then someone think, then air makes sound, but have no ear, cannot hear sound. So maybe my ear makes sound. Then somebody think of the ear makes sound. Have no consciousness, also no sound. Okay, we have consciousness. Then sound appears, sound. Then maybe the consciousness makes sound. Then consciousness, highest consciousness, we say mind. Mind makes sound. So six kinds of changing. The sound comes from where? Table. The sound comes from where? Maybe the stick. The next comes from where? The air. The next comes from where? Ear. The next comes from consciousness. Next one, mind. So, six changing. Okay? That's what we say thinking. So, this sound comes from where? I ask him, the sound comes from where? Correct. Not changing. Just do it. That explanation. The sound comes from a table, and stack, air, ear, consciousness, mind. Changing. Six steps. Changing. That's a thinking. Here, not thinking only. The stick, the sound comes from where? Then he only holding stick. or do it. Explanation, not important. So, everything explanation is a mistake. That's a thinking. So, correct practicing means cut our thinking, straight, boom, point our mind, get enlightenment. That's the Zen, okay? Okay, question over?
You know, we talk, we communicate, when we talk to each other, we exchange the ideas, and without the ideas, we cannot communicate. And indeed, you know, when I listen to you, ideas seem to hinder our path to enlightenment. So, in a way, the human being is, in a way, cursed, you know, because we have ideas.
Now, what kind of idea do you have?
What
kind of idea do you have?
I am talking about, you know, the, in general, human being communicate. We speak each other. And then without the ideas, we cannot speak. So, why the animals don't seem to, you know, the you know, speak to each other? Does that mean that the animals have, you know, reached the enlightenment? You know, why human beings are so cursed because we have ideas and we have such, you know, difficulty to reach enlightenment because we have ideas?
What kind of idea do you have?
I don't have ideas.
You have no idea.
I only have.
Then don't talk to me, okay? No idea, no problem. You have idea, you have problem, okay? Idea is okay. Idea. Have idea. Have no idea. Doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Okay.
Isn't it better that we rather sing and dance instead of talking about?
Listen to me. Don't make your idea, okay? Idea is okay. I have idea, have no idea, doesn't matter. How correct, if we have idea, how correct function your idea? That's very important. Have no idea, how correct function no idea? That's very important.
I think it's in a way the idea.
So you are touching your idea.
I'm speaking about anybody's idea.
Anybody? Don't talk about anybody. Talk to you. What's your idea?
Well, I'm talking about my idea as well as the Buddha's idea.
Your idea is the Buddha's idea?
No, it's not.
That's wonderful.
Could be.
Huh?
I deny that either. But, you know, what I'm talking about is...
I ask you, okay, you mean understanding. Who are you? Who are you?
I am me.
I am me? What does it mean?
Well, I don't ask you that question because I don't like to have an idea.
That's the Zen talk. We are talk about Zen class, okay? So I ask you, what are you? If you don't understand, only don't know. Okay? Don't make your idea. Your idea is not your idea. That's somebody's idea. Somebody goes, you go to school, primary school, high school, university, then into teacher, all somebody's idea. Not your idea. What is your idea?
The problem here is that if I say I don't know who I am, then you tell me that you don't understand yourself. If I say yes, I know myself, that's only an idea. That's useless.
It's
a no-win situation.
They cannot win. If he say, I understand myself, you say, no good. If he say, I don't understand myself, then you say, you don't understand yourself.
Sorry. I have stick. Too much talking, stick walking, okay? So very important.
That's why I'm
laughing. So, very important, talking, infinity. But through idea means where, without thinking. Through idea means without thinking. Without thinking means without speech. So a long time ago, Lynch said any kind of question, only ka. Doksan said any kind of question, only hit. Guji said not any kind of question, only one thing. So if you attain Doksan said hit, Guji said not one thing, or Lynch said not ka, then attain yourself. That's a very important point. So, Zen is not Zen. If you want to understand your true self, not depend on word and speech. That is Zen. So, we are today compulsory talking means many people too much understanding. So, how take away understanding? So, heart sickness, heart medicine necessary. Cold sickness, cold medicine necessary. Too much understanding, too much understanding medicine necessary. So we talk about the compulsory Zen. Okay? So, talking, then rest. Oh, my understanding is somebody's idea, not my idea. What's my true idea? Don't understand. Yeah? So, talk about the compass. Then today we begin talking. Then your understanding, digest, become yours. Then this understanding become wisdom. That's the compass of teaching. So I hope today everybody coming here, thank you very much. So continue tomorrow. We are continue Hinayana Buddhism. Listen to Dharma speech means very important. This world, many human beings, but this condition comes from where? Okay, anytime talk about 1945, 2 billion people, many thousand years only passed. Almost 50 years, 3 billion people up here, boom, up here. So, this consciousness comes from where? Human beings are too much kid or animals. They eat meat, something that. So, all this consciousness, human being consciousness, face is a human being. But this consciousness, dog, cat, lion, snake, any kind of animal consciousness coming in. So, that's the cleanliness. Cleaning. Then animal consciousness all take away. 100% of human consciousness, return to human consciousness. Then we have love, great compassion, great bodhisattva appear. Then help this world is possible. So that is the Buddha's teaching. So thank you very much today coming here. So coming here tomorrow. Same time, we continue Hinayana Buddhism, Mahayana Buddhism lecture. So, please come. Also, today come in here, listen to Dharma. Thank you very much.
So, thank you very much, Taegosa Sunim and Mu Ryang Sunim. And thank you all very much for coming. We have practice every morning at 5:30 and every evening at 7 o'clock. You're welcome to come. And as the Sunstein said, our lectures will continue for the next 5 nights. We'd like to be able to give you all these books tonight, but unfortunately, these are the only copies we have right now, so we have to collect them. We hope later in the program we can give these out. Meanwhile, these talks have been produced through the efforts of many people. And if anyone feels like leaving a donation in the box in the hall, that would be very much appreciated. And now we are going to have some tea downstairs. Please join us. Thank you very much. Yeah. Good talk. Oh, really?
Yeah, I'm glad you're...